Hello friends, we are at the 14th lecture of our microbiology lecture series, and in this lecture we want to talk about microbial ecology. So we want to talk about the microbial diversity in the environment. We are going to talk about the basics of microbial ecology and the components of microbial ecology. We'll also talk about the role of microorganisms in the ecosystem and how they survive, how they fit into the ecological food chain. So that's what we're going to talk. Stay tuned and watch this lecture. So let's begin with it. Now, what we need to understand when we talk about ecology and ecosystem, we want to know the importance of organisms living in the ecosystem. So here we want to know the importance of microorganisms. Okay, so you can see that how exactly this whole ecosystem works. Okay, so animals and plants both are related to one another. Particularly, animals are dependent on plants because plants are the producers, so they are producing food, and animal eats plants as a food source. Okay, and once animal utilize oxygen for respiration, produce CO2, plants take up that CO2, assimilate the carbon in CO2 into food, and then after the death of animal and plant, okay, they turn into detritus, and then microbial systems means microorganisms, bacteria and fungi, both can act as a microbial system, can convert the detritus into other components, carbon dioxide, ammonium, phosphate. These are the components that they produce. So microbial system responsible for the decomposition of the dead organic material, which is known as detritus, under aerobic as well as anaerobic condition, and then they will produce components which will be again released into the nature, released into the environment, like CO2, NH4, PO4, those things. So again, plants can take up this ammonium, phosphate, because these things are present in the soil and CO2 is present in the air, and plant will again utilize it and produce food, and this cycle continues like that. So this is the actual functional role of a microorganism and microbial system in the environment. Now think about it. Strong evidence now supports that the presence of biosphere living up to 1 kilometer below Earth's surface, and the bacteria in this deep biosphere have been found in even crystalline basalt rocks below marine sediments, and their biomass is on order of the above of the surface. The biosphere is driven by geogases and similar to the deep ocean vent ecosystem. Okay, so think about it. When we can find out microorganisms 1 kilometer below the Earth's surface, as well as we can find that 1 kilometer deep down the marine sediments, the similar type of environment is also present in other planets like Mars. And it is possible to find bacteria living 1, 2, 5 kilometers down the Mars and other planets' surface as well, right? Because these microorganisms, they don't always need solid food to live. They need an energy source, they need a carbon source. Once they find that, they can continue to live. So that source of carbon they can obtain from atmosphere, from air. Okay, so geogases can provide them with this nutrients, okay, with the carbon source. So think about it. You can have acetogenic bacteria, acetoclassic methanogens, and autotrophic methanogens. Okay, all this autotrophic methanogens and acetoclastic methanogens, both these types, they are methanogens, means ultimately when they utilize geogases like carbon dioxide or hydrogen gas, they utilize this gas and they produce methane, and they remove the methane out, and this methane, which is an organic polymer, that can be again degraded anaerobically and further produce again carbon dioxide and hydrogen. So it's a positive feedback loop that continues. So while methanogens taking up hydrogen and carbon dioxide gas, they're producing methane, and methane is again organized into organic polymers, because they can produce the hydrocarbon chain, the organic polymer, and again this organic polymer can be anaerobically degraded and they can produce the CO2 and hydrogen again. Okay, so this process continues. Acetogenic bacteria can produce acetate, and this acetate can be utilized by iron reducing bacteria, and they can also produce organic polymer, and again the process of degrading organic polymer into hydrogen and carbon dioxide continues. Okay, so this is how deep biosphere functions. You can see a bacteria does not require any solid nutrients to live and survive. They only need the gaseous environment, hydrogen, carbon dioxide. Done. They can utilize them and they can produce this positive feedback loop, utilizing them vigorously and producing energy and living comfortably. For example, you talk about this same type of environment there in rumen of cow. So you call the microbial ecosystem in the rumen. Complex anaerobic microbial system found in this rumen. As you can see, this is a cow, and actually there is literally a hole in the stomach of the cow. You can see this is the hole, okay, hole in the stomach. Now we feed them with grasses or grains which contain cellulose and starch. It is converted to glucose. Then a fermentation of glucose produces lactate, succinate, formate and all. Formate can be degraded into hydrogen and carbon dioxide, which is used by methanogens, that is living in the rumen, in the gut of the cow. And they are methanogens, so they will take this hydrogen and carbon dioxide as a gas and produce methane and carbon dioxide, which both are greenhouse gases, and that can be released out. Okay, while lactate and succinate can produce acetate, propionate, butyrate, and they can be digested, okay, by the cow itself. Okay, so reactions mediated by dozens of bacterial species including protozoan such as ciliates. Okay, so this similar systems are also found in termites, but in a little different manner. The chemical process remains the same, but the way it works and the locations are different. So in cow, we can create this, like we can literally drill a hole through the stomach and we can insert this methanogens there, who can utilize this hydrogen and carbon dioxide gas and produce CH4 and CO2, and they can release it outside. So they help in the digestion of the cow, and that helps in utilization of all the feed that we provide them, and maximum nutrients can be absorbed by the cow, so the cow can live healthy and we can get maximum output from the cow. So complex anaerobic microbial system found in this case, right? As we discussed earlier, chemical potential exploitation. Now it's all about, when we talk about this utilization of carbon and energy source, it's all chemical processes. Okay, so hydrogen sulfide oxidation by nitrate, then there is a system called anammox, then there is a methane oxidation by sulfate. So think about all these situations where hydrogen sulfide is oxidized by nitrate. And there are anammox situations where ammonium is again interacting with nitrite to produce nitrogen, and nitrogen can be released into the air as free nitrogen source. So this is like ammonia, like nitrogen can be assimilated into the soil as ammonia, nitrogen assimilation. So there is also another process of removal of this nitrogen into the air, and that is anammox. Okay, it's a one-step process, jumping two different steps of ammonium, like nitrogen assimilation. Like methane oxidation by sulfate again can be done by few bacteria. Okay, so the different research papers are listed here who found out these different discoveries, particularly in 1999 and 2000s. And methane oxidation by nitrate, you can see how exactly methane oxidation is done by nitrate. So particularly methane or hydrogen sulfide can be oxidized by nitrate. Ammonium can be oxidized by nitrite. And methane can also be oxidized by sulfate. So nitrate, nitrite, sulfate, these are the oxidizing agents who can oxidize harmful components like hydrogen sulfide, methane. And they can produce, ultimately they can produce carbon dioxide gas, water and nitrogen gas, hydrogen gas. So you know, in environment, the microbes play a vital role in converting methane or ammonium into like hydrogen sulfide into less toxic gaseous components like carbon dioxide, nitrogen, hydrogen, water, those things. So this is the feature. By different chemical measurements they convert it, and mostly these processes are oxidation, and oxidizing agents are nitrate or nitrites. Microbiome. Human, if you think about the somatic and germ cells, near about 10 trillion microbes are found. And you know, the genome, 20,000 protein encoding genes are present, okay, among there. And if you think about the intestinal microbiota, the cells, 100 trillion. So think about the somatic and germ cells in human body is 10 trillion with 20,000 protein coding genes. While if you think about the microorganisms present in our body, our own cells are 10 trillion only, while intestinal microbiota is 100 trillion, which is 10 times that of, 100 times in this case is same. So it's 10 times of the total cells, and metagenome is almost 100 times than the human genome of the body. So think about it. So the microbiota that is found in our body, starting from the nasal cavity, oral cavity, skin, gastrointestinal region, urogenital region, these are the components. The maximum is found in the gastrointestinal place, where we have 100 trillion cells of microbes, which is 10 times greater than the total number of cells found in our body. Okay, and then there are almost microorganisms, skin, urogenital tract, oral and nasal cavity. Got it? Okay. So other examples of microbially coupled systems, where we find out that in our body also you can see in intestine microbes are present, and this interaction is symbiotic, and this interaction is beneficial, like mutual understanding between the microorganisms living there and us, because microbes get nutrients from us, and instead microbes also got anaerobic environment sometimes, and in return what we get is that these microorganisms present there, they produce vitamin K, they help in our proper absorption of the food, they help in the digestion a little bit, and the most importantly, they help in producing a strong immunity there, so that some pathogen cannot colonize there easily. They will prevent foreign pathogen colonization in our intestine, and they protect us against different intestinal diseases. Now the situation is, if we remove all the intestinal microflora of our body, then ultimately we will feel more sick for the intestinal diseases and different infections, pathogen infections like salmonellosis, as well as, you know, different toxin mediated diseases, diarrhea and all these diseases quite often. So this intestinal microbiota protects us against this. So apart from the intestines, if you think about the interactions between this other microbes in microbial interaction, then we'll find this lichen, which is also symbiotic relation between a fungi and algae living together with this gorgeous color. Okay, dinoflagellates inside a flatworm. So this is a flatworm. You can see inside the flatworm belly, it's filled with small dinoflagellates which live together. In fact, it's a huge number. Sulfur bacteria in Riftia, they present together. Okay, so if you look at the Riftia, this is the coral like structures underwater, sulfur bacteria present there. And mycorrhiza, which provides essential benefits to plants, and particularly, you know, that's the reason we produce mycorrhizal culture separately, and people add that into their soil when they plant trees, so that the plant can take up nutrients properly and they can fix the nitrogen quite well and can utilize the nitrate and ammonium from the soil properly. Okay, so these are the different types of interactions that are found in the nature apart from the human body. Prokaryotic differentiation. Cell-to-cell signaling compounds are present, such as N-acetyl homoserine lactones. They allow bacterial species to exhibit multicellular characteristics, and this is very, very important to understand the multicellular characteristics of a bacteria. You know, particularly when we see the bacterial culture, bacterial colony, we'll find it's of a particular shape. Sometimes it can be smooth, sometimes it can be rough. It looks like you can see in this picture, there are different shape if you look at here. So different species and different type of microorganism colonize differently in the agar plate, because they have a particular way of arranging themselves to one another, attaching themselves to one another. It's always true that one particular microorganism is not enough to cause any disease or not enough to colonize itself. So they need help from other of their own members to link properly. Some of them arrange like a chain, some of them arrange like a stack, some of them arrange like a layer, and that's how they form the tissue layer. So microbial systems are used as a model system, closed systems such as Earth. So think about it. energy is the key to drive this system. So energy is present, primary producers take up this energy, and producers are producing food, and consumers are taking up this this food. Okay, consumers are taking up the food, and by this means of food production, they produce heat, that is entropy, chaos is increasing outside, and consumers start eating the primary producers, and then consumers are also producing few resources for self-organization, and these some resources, particularly like CO2, H2O, hydrogen, nitrogen, in some occasions, these are few occasions, but CO2 and H2O. So these components are used by the primary producers along with energy to produce food. So you know, when we discuss about the primary producer and consumer, we always say that consumer are dependent on primary producers. But if you look at this picture, you get a sense that the primary producers are somehow indirectly get some benefit from the consumer itself, because the consumer are producing some sort of resources like CO2 and water that can be utilized by the primary producers. Okay. So habitats and biogeochemistry. The world is not well mixed, as we know. So that sources and sinks of matter and energy produce gradients and microenvironments. Microbial communities develop as a function of resource availability. So think about it. If you look at here, that in deep lake and as well as in gradients in particles, think about the differences. In the deep lake, you can see there are different zones. Photic zone, aphotic zone, anaerobic sediments. Photic zones are aerobic, both photic as well as aphotic zone. But the difference between photic and aphotic is that photic zone receives maximum sunlight. That's why photic. Aphotic means they don't receive that much of sunlight, but both are aerobic. So they are exposed to oxygen properly. Okay, so light concentration, you can see the availability of the right, the amount of light available both in photic and aphotic zone are different. It's more in photic, it's very less in aphotic. You can see the decrease, it's very less in aphotic. But the oxygen availability is almost the same present in photic and aphotic zone. Dissolved oxygen is well available. But from the anaerobic sediments, you see the oxygen concentration is decreased suddenly. In the anaerobic sediment, as it's a sediment, it's not the water layer, it is sediment made up with soil, clay and other rock components. So here the oxygen concentration decreases dramatically. It's an anaerobic condition. Example of this: hot spring, deep sea vents, hypersaline and anoxic environments, you can see. And not only it's about the photic and oxygen's availability, think about the oxygen's availability in the radius. It also, oxygen is available based on the radius systems as well. So the radius, as we are going down the radius, the oxygen availability getting less and less. It's available more in the outside surrounding radius. Now when we are talking about the microbial ecosystem, when we talk about microorganisms, we're talking about small things, miniature things. So how small we are thinking? Microbiology requires a microscope to study, we all know that. The planktons are the primary producers in the aquatic environment. So particularly there are phytoplanktons and zooplanktons. Phytoplanktons are autotrophic, they are the producers. Phototrophic means they will autotrophic means they are capable of producing their own food, and they utilize energy directly from sun, so they are photoautotrophic. And zooplanktons are there which are heterotrophic. Okay, that means they don't utilize the sun's energy directly, they utilize other chemical source as an energy source, other chemicals as an energy source to use it. So phytoplankton are very very small, is the smallest. So they are mostly viruses, 0.02 to 0.2 micrometer. Picoplankton, 0.2 to 2 micrometer, bacteria, cyanobacteria. Nanoplankton, 2 to 20 micrometer, which are flagellates and dinoflagellates. Microplankton, example diatoms and ciliates, 20 to 200 micrometer. And mesoplankton, example zooplanktons, copepods, greater than 200 micrometer. So zooplanktons and mesoplanktons, which are much bigger than the phytoplanktons. And among phytoplanktons, we have femtoplankton, picoplankton, nanoplankton and microplanktons, right? So think about here, when we talk about the, here we are talking about, we are talking about the diameter. Okay, so what we know in the in this ecosystem, we have two types of cell, prokaryotes and eukaryotes. And we know about the differences between prokaryotes and quite well. Prokaryotes and eukaryotes, the major difference is that in eukaryotes we have membrane bound organelles, while in prokaryotes we don't have any membrane bound organelles. So in eukaryotes, larger cells that contain nucleus with DNA organized into chromosomes, okay, and organelles like mitochondria, chloroplasts are usually present. So the examples of different eukaryotes: algae, fungi, protozoa, mesozoa, metazoa. Algae, phototrophic, they can be single cells or can be present in colonies. Fungi, heterotrophic, single cells like yeast or multicellular like molds and mushrooms, and they have cell wall. This is the unique feature about fungi. Protozoans, they are single cells lacking rigid cell wall, and they also are heterotrophic. So fungi and protozoa both depends on the other autotrophs for their food. Metazoans like plants and animals. Among plants are phototrophic because they can produce their own food. Animals, heterotrophic, cannot produce their own food. And the difference between plants and animals are plenty, but we know that animals have a cell differentiation and specific cells of specific functions. Okay. So the five kingdom concepts for old phylogeny utilizes this concept. Now we only talk about three domain concept. Okay, I mean eukarya, bacteria and archaea. We'll talk about that in a moment. But earlier times, we are old phylogeny, where five kingdom concept are famous, like Animalia, Plantae, Fungi, Protista and Monera. When animal and mammals are multicellular, they contains organ, no cell wall, ingest, nutrition, nervous system and locomotion is present. Plantae, multicellular, cellulose is present in the cell wall, photosynthetic, no nervous system, no locomotion, which is differing Plantae from Animalia. Fungi, mostly multicellular, the cell wall contains chitin, it absorbs food, no nervous system, no locomotion, and fungi can also become a kind of decomposers. Protista, mostly unicellular or simple multicellular, mostly are unicellular, means made up with one cell, few are present with multiple cells. Some have cell walls, they can absorb food, ingest and photosynthesize. So everything is possible by Protista, because Protista is a mixed group. They don't have any nervous system, but some of them has locomotion. Monera, mostly unicellular, some are colonial, means they produce colony. Cell walls are produced by polysaccharides. It absorbs food, chemosynthesizes, means they take energy from the carbon source from chemicals, and they can also sometimes photosynthesize. No nervous system, locomotion is found in some of the Monera. Phylogeny from DNA sequences. Now there are modern methods to be used in the phylogeny analysis, and the methodology is to compare DNA sequences of different organisms, because we sequence them and then we compare the DNA sequences. We can compare them because we have the databases with the DNA sequence, the complete DNA sequence of different organisms, and compare them online in the database. When you run BLAST with bioinformatics, we get to know the similarity score between two organisms. Okay, two same organism has the 100% identical similarity, and less than that means they have a little bit of difference. Closer DNA sequences are to each other, closer the evolutionary distance separating the organisms. And we use DNA of ribosomal RNA, like rRNA. Since all organisms have rRNA, our RNAs are evolutionary stable. rRNA have not changed much through the evolution time scale. That's why you use rRNAs, okay, to compare between the organisms. Okay, so if you look at here, that the evolution distance, we are looking at different organism A, B, C, D, and we are checking the different similarity and differences. You can see that the difference here is between A and B is only once. This G, this is the only place to differ. Rest everything is same. So only difference is one base. Between A and C, if you think about here, these three bases are different. So between A and C, we have 1, 2, 3 bases difference. Between B and C, we also have 3 bases difference. Between A and D, we have 4 bases that are 4 places which are different. Okay? five places which are different, you can see. So this is how we can assume, like by looking at this DNA sequences, you can see that the least similarity is present between A and D, because five bases are different between A and D, and the closest relative is A and B and C and D. So think about it, A and B are closest relatives and A and D are distant most relatives. So A and B are very close, that means A and B share a common ancestor. So A and B share a common ancestor from where A and B branched. Similarly, C and D shared a common ancestor from where C and D are branched. And now, rest of the others are branched from a other common ancestor. So this will be the place. Okay. So A, B, C, D is done. And this is how it's placed. So this is how we produce the phylogenetic tree. And if you want to understand how exactly phylogenetic tree is created and the methods to do that, you can watch the lecture in my channel regarding the phylogenetic tree analysis and how to do that. Okay. Now, in the modern era, the phylogenetic tree that we have created in recent times, based on the 16S rRNA and 18S rRNA sequence. Okay, and this system is brought by the Carl R. Ouse. So this system is known as three domain concept. So every single organism in planet can be divided into three domains. No big deal. No 5-10 different regions. Only three domains: bacteria, archaea, eukarya. That's all. Archaea are the primitive organisms, but they are mostly, they either hyperthermophiles or halophiles. Means they love to be present and survive in a thermophilic environments or halophilic environments, where the temperature is boiling hot or the pH is very high or low. Archaea can survive in these rough environmental conditions. So in most of the places where we found living creatures in very cold or very hot environments, they turn to be archaea. Then comes bacteria. Bacteria are present in every single locations. Okay, so they are also dynamic, ranging from 2-5 degrees Celsius temperature till 60-70 degrees Celsius temperature, they can survive. And then there are eukarya, which are multicellular, and eukarya contains fungi, plants, ciliates, slime molds, flagellates. Okay, so everything is present in the eukarya, because eukarya in this case means multicellular, that's all. Okay, and bacteria means prokaryotes, and archaea is little different, although archaea has more similarity with eukarya than the similarity with bacteria. So think about this picture. This is a common ancestor. We call them last unknown common ancestor, or LUCA. Okay, a last universal common ancestor, LUCA. From this common ancestor, one branch that produced bacteria at the beginning, and then another branch continues. After some time, there is another common ancestor, and from this ancestor branch into archaea, and another branch produce eukarya. So you think that archaea and eukarya both share one common ancestor, while bacteria and archaea does not have that common ancestor sharing. So eukarya and archaea have more similarity than the archaea has with bacteria. So in bacteria, there are 15 phylums, you can see. All these phylums are listed: Aquiflates, Thermotoga, Flavobacteria, Cyanobacteria, Chloroplast, Purple Bacteria, Mitochondria became a part, because chloroplast and mitochondria both are listed inside a bacteria, because these are bacteria which gets internalized into a eukaryotic cell and then became the organelle inside the eukaryotes. But they actually are bacteria. They actually were bacteria. So we call it endosymbiotic theory. Then gram positive bacteria, and then green non-sulfur bacteria came later. In archaea, you can see different four phylums are present. And those phylums are, one type are hyperthermophiles, known as psychrophilic, halophiles, known as methanogens, and hyperthermophiles. So these two, hyperthermophiles and halophiles, are the major type, but four phylums are present in this occasion. Okay, methanobacterium, extreme halophiles, thermoplasma, thermococcus, thermoproteus, methanococcus, pyrodictium. So these are the examples of archaea. Pyrodictium type. So these are all the different phylums, the types: pyrodictium, thermococcus, methanococcus, thermoproteus, methanobacterium, thermoplasma, extreme halophiles. Okay, and by the name you can understand, Anything with the thermoname means they live in the very hot climate. Halophiles live in a you know, changing osmolarity. Okay, changing osmolarity is the place where the halophiles are present. And also pH variations are there. They can also survive hugely pH variation. And in eukaryotes, you can see protists, fungi, plants and animals are present in eukarya. So in the five kingdom concept provided by Whittaker, this protists, fungi, plants, animalia, all are placed inside eukarya. And then rest prokaryotes are made in a separate domain, bacteria. And the last and newly found domain became archaea. Okay. Now the most important part for CSIRnet gate perspective is to know the difference between archaea, bacteria and eukarya. So think about the trait carbon linkage of lipids. In bacteria it's ester linked, the hydrogen and carbon, you know, the hydrocarbon chain linked with the glycerol backbone. Okay, and this linkage in bacteria it's ester linked, in eukarya it's also ester linked, in archaea it's ether linked. Phosphate backbone of lipids. Bacteria, glycerol 3-phosphate became the phosphate backbone. Eukarya also glycerol 3-phosphate. Archaea has glycerol 1-phosphate. So you know these two trait, the lipids and the lipid link with the phosphate backbone, are similar between bacteria and eukarya. So these two have similarity, archaea has difference. Metabolism, bacteria, bacterial metabolism. Archaea has a bacteria-like metabolism. Eukarya has a eukaryotic metabolism. So in metabolism, bacteria and archaea is similar. Now think about nucleus. Absent in both bacteria and archaea, so they have similarity. Organelles not present in bacteria and archaea, they have similarity. Spliceosomal introns, so there is no introns present in bacteria and archaea, they have similarity. Telomeres, no telomeres found in bacteria and archaea, similarity. Chromosome shape, bacteria and archaea are mostly circular, similarity, while eukarya linear. DNA replication, now from here, DNA replication, transcription and translation. Bacteria has a bacterial replication, bacterial transcription, bacterial translation process. While archaea and eukarya have similarity in replication, transcription and translation. Okay, so think about it, we have found few properties which are similar between bacteria and archaea, we have found few properties similar between archaea and eukarya, and we have found few properties similar between eukarya and bacteria, that is only these two, carbon linkage of lipids and phosphate backbone of lipids. Okay, so here again the similarity is listed. Okay, so between eukarya and archaea there are more similarity, as you can see. For example, methionine E is the initiator amino acid of protein synthesis. Both in archaea and eukarya are true. In bacteria, formyl methionine is used, so it's not true. Lack of peptidoglycan in cell wall in both archaea and eukarya, but bacteria has a lot of peptidoglycan in cell wall. Growth not inhibited by streptomycin and chloramphenicol. So if you use antibiotic like streptomycin, chloramphenicol, they are going to kill bacteria, but they are not going to kill archaea, they are not going to kill eukarya. Histones are associated with DNA both in archaea as well as eukarya. Histones are present, histones are found, they are associated with the DNA, and bacteria they don't have any histones associated with the DNA. DNA is naked inside the cytosol. Contains several types of RNA polymerase. In archaea as well as in eukarya, they carry multiple RNA polymerase. RNA polymerase 1, 2, 3 different types. Well, in bacteria, there is only one type of RNA polymerase found. Okay, so these are the similarity between archaea and eukarya. But now if you look at the similarity between archaea and bacteria, as we know, chromosomes are circular between the two. Nuclear envelope are absent in both. Membrane bound organelles are absent in both. Okay, so this is the similarity and dissimilarity between eukarya and archaea, eukarya and bacteria and archaea. Now, as I said earlier, that the chloroplast and mitochondria, they are nothing but prokaryotic organisms which were free living at some point of the time in evolutionary history, and then they are internalized. So this is universal ancestral prokaryote. From there branched into archaea, first branching to bacteria, then a second branching to archaea and eukarya. So among some of the bacteria, they are this chloroplast or mitochondria, they are present as a prokaryotes. And sooner when the eukaryotic cells are produced, then this small prokaryotes are internalized by the eukaryotic cell inside of the cell. And once they are internalized inside the cell, because you know these prokaryotes, they have their own genetic material, and they utilize their own genetic material for their transcription and protein synthesis, replication inside. So they are self-replicating components, and when they start replicating itself inside the cell, inside the eukaryotic cell, so eukaryotic cell start getting benefit from these structures. For example, from mitochondria, they start getting benefit of producing energy, and eukaryotic cell can now get energy from the mitochondria, and then can utilize the mitochondria as a powerhouse. And chloroplasts contain this chloroplasts contain this chlorophyll, which can be utilized by that eukaryotes to photosynthesize and produce food. So that provides them benefit, and as that provides benefit to the cell utilize that, and they are going to divide and replicate into two. So once the cell continues to divide into multiple cells, sooner new cells start containing that cell. And mitochondria, they also get benefit, mitochondria and chloroplasts, they also get benefit of receiving nutrients and other components by the cell. So it's a symbiotic relationship between this prokaryotic cell and the eukaryotic cell. That's why the prokaryotic cell remained there and lived there. So that's how we find out this mitochondria and chloroplast to be a part of this eukaryotic cell later on. And a few of these cells which receives mitochondria became animal cells, and those received this chloroplast along with mitochondria became plant cells. Think about the evolution of life and how oxygen, atmospheric oxygen, drive it. You can think about it, the origin of life from there after the chemical evolution. And it produced bacteria, then produced archaea, nuclear line, and from the nuclear line the eukaryotes are produced later on, and the microbial diversification took place, and you know, small modification taken place at a time, because earlier there is a part known as anoxic environment, where the environment, the atmosphere lacks oxygen, because the atmosphere filled with nitrogen, hydrogen, ammonium, this kind of gases. But now this anoxic environment is altered, it's changed, and oxygen start building up, and you can see the evolution of photosystem too taken place. And you can see that oxygen concentration increases slowly from 0.1%. The origin of oxygen in phototrophs like cyanobacteria, they start using very low amount of oxygen, and then oxygenated environment where 1% of the oxygen. Then origin of modern eukaryotes, when the oxygen percent is 10%, and now near about 20% of the oxygen, origin of metazoans. So you know, the more the cells become, the more the origin, the complex the body of the organism become, the more oxygen demand they start to do. So more oxygen demand means 20% ultimately at the end, 20% of the oxygen, 20% oxygen saturation in the atmosphere leads to the utilization of the oxygen. And metazoans utilize the 20% of the oxygen, and they start growing. And time is a pre-Cambrian to Cambrian time, where the morphological evolution of metazoans take place, and then become the age of dinosaurs later on. Okay, so these are the steps from the formation of the Earth, which is near about 4.5 and 10 to the power 9 years before the present time. Then after chemical evolution, origin of life at the anoxic environment, then slowly they turn into the oxygenated environment, starting from 0.1% utilized by the cyanobacteria, and then goes to 20% when the metazoans originated. Now if you think about these microorganisms and how they are utilizing energy, they are mostly utilizing redox reactions for the production of the energy. And when you say redox, that means reduction and oxidation. And the easy way to remember is oil rig. Oxidation is losing electron, reduction is gaining electron. Okay. So the Gibbs free energy change is listed, which we are not concerned to talk about. But think about it, the redox reactions for an oxidation is when the component A is converted to B plus and electron is removed. While in reduction, electron is taken, electron is used. Okay? Remember that. In oxidation, electron is produced. In reduction, electron is utilized. So aerobic respiration example, organic and inorganic. Organic, when the CH2O oxygen is utilized to produce carbon dioxide and water. Inorganic, when ammonium and oxygen is utilized to produce nitrate, water and hydrogen. Okay, so both are oxidation reactions for aerobic respiration. For anaerobic respiration, we can use the organic compound, hydrocarbons. Sulfate is used, produce carbon dioxide, sulfur, hydroxyl and hydrogen, that can be the reduced, like converted to water later. This is the organic method. If you use inorganic gas like CO2 and hydrogen together, produce methane and water. On the other hand, if you think about the fermentation take place in anaerobic condition only. So in anaerobic condition, we have seen two examples where we use organic material and when microbe can use inorganic material. But in fermentation also, they utilize sugar. You can see C6H12O6, the sugar components, and they can also produce carbon dioxide and the hydrocarbon chain. In this case, you know, aldehyde, and from there it can produce ethanol as a fermented product or lactic acid as a fermented product. So these are all regarding microorganisms who are utilizing inorganic or organic in carbon source. But apart from that, there are situations known as autotrophy. Autotrophy is a situation where carbon dioxide is used and the energy from sun is used. Okay, and there are photosystems that help microorganisms to harvest the sun energy. So there are two photosystems, photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. Few microorganisms have only photosystem 1, few of them have photosystem 1 and 2 together. Now either way, these photosystems are filled with photopigments known as like chlorophyll, photopigment or chlorophylls. So the chlorophyll is also known as photopigment or antenna pigment, who receives sunlight and gets excited. When it gets excited, then they are going to release electron, and the electron gets transferred from one photosystem to the other from the higher energy state. And there are electron carriers embedded into the membrane of chloroplast. I mean, not the chloroplast membrane, but membrane of the thylakoid. And as a result of which, that leads to a process in production of energy that produces ATP, which is a energy currency inside the cell, which can be utilized by the cell quite easily. So ATP can be utilized. So this is a photo reaction, okay, or light reaction. So light reaction is a place where ATP is produced, and when ATP is produced, the ATP is utilized by the plants as well as the microorganisms who has chlorophyll. They harvest this energy to produce further food. So they assimilate the carbon from carbon dioxide into organic compound. Okay. Hopefully you understood the process of then the basics of microbial ecology. If you get this idea, put a thumbs up and also share this video with your friends so that we also get to share our information via you and many, as many students as you can get. And please hit that subscribe button so that you'd never miss an update from us.